Why do bad things happen to good people? This morning, this is a message especially for guests and visitors, but others too. I trust the Lord will minister to you through this message. I want to begin with an anecdote. I'm not sure if it actually happened, probably not, but it illustrates my point. The doctor was speaking to a patient and said these words. He said, "I have some bad news to give you and some very bad news." And so the patient was naturally distressed. The doctor said, "You know what? The results of your tests have come, and the bad news is that you have only 24 hours to live." Of course, the patient was really distraught. He knew that something was wrong with his body. He knew it was serious, but he didn't realize it was that serious. And then as he was processing that, he said, "What could be worse than this? 24 hours to live. What is the very bad news?" Sheepishly, the doctor, after a moment of silence, his head bowed, he lifted up, he said, "You know what? I should have told you this 24 hours ago." It is a humorous story. It is not meant to be taken seriously. But friends, I do have some bad news for you today. And then I have some very bad news. And if that's all I had, I wouldn't even begin speaking to you. I have, after the bad news and very bad news, can you guess? Some good news. The good news is what I want. I'm waiting to get to. The bad news is that all is not right with the world. The world has something seriously wrong with it. And the bad things that happen to us are merely symptoms of a disease. The Bible teaches that the world wasn't always like this. It was created good. When God first created the world, he created it good. But then man, as the regent of creation, the person responsible for the order of creation, sinned against God. And by that act, sin entered the world. And the entrance of sin has been like a deadly virus. It has corrupted the human heart, not just of our original parents, but since then, it infects every human heart. But not just individuals. This virus has affected society and poisoned relationships in society. And if you want to know why, despite the best efforts of the brightest minds on the planet, we still have wars, riots. Now you know the reason. It's because of this poison that has infected not just the individual hearts of people, it's infected society. But the Bible says not only that, it has gone beyond just human society to creation itself. So the Bible in fact says creation as we know it, beautiful though is it, it is in bondage to decay. And so that's the bad news, that sin has all pervasive, it's infected every crevice and corner of our planet and our world. Pastor, that's depressing. I know. But it's the truth. But then what is the very bad news? That is bad news. What could be worse? Well, the very bad news is that even good people are not insulated from the symptoms of a world that has been affected by sin. I know many of us sit here and we have a subconscious sense of entitlement. We feel like, you know what, I'm doing the best I can in living a good life. I can understand why sin affects bad people. But me, I'm good. Sorry if that's very bad news, but it's true. None of us is insulated from the influence of this dreadful infection. A world gone bad. Why do bad things happen to good people? Well, I'm going to give you a few reasons, and I want you to consider them very carefully before I go on to the good news. Why do bad things happen to good people? The first thing I want to say is that bad and good people both live in a bad world. And I've already, I think, prepared the ground for the statement. But what I want to do is just give you a few symptoms of the disease to illustrate this. What are the symptoms of a world gone bad? The most common are, of course, what we call natural disasters. Floods, earthquakes, fires, tidal waves, tsunamis, nuclear accidents, disease epidemics, building collapses. Many of these, not all, but many of these are not engineered by any human hand. Nobody presses a button somewhere that creates a flood. Nobody plans for you and I to suffer the effects of a famine. These things happen. They come suddenly. They create chaos and devastation. And natural disasters strike terror in human hearts. Mostly because we feel helpless. We cannot control them. We cannot prevent them. Nor can we control them or escape them. And worst of all, they seem so unpredictable. So random. We could be, unfortunately, Calcutta is not really an earthquake-prone area, but in some parts of Japan or in California, you could be sitting in a service like this or enjoying a beautiful meal or in a wedding, and suddenly it hits. And your world comes crashing down. Natural disasters sometimes make it seem as though life is a game of chance. A dice is thrown. Person A escapes. Person B is trapped. And I know you've heard of instances like this, right? You know, everyone is supposed to go on a trip, and then suddenly one person decides not to go, and that bus has an accident. Why? You're about to get into a vehicle, and usually you sit on the right side, but that day you decide to sit on the left side, and there's an accident, and the person on the right side is killed. You've heard of instances like this? Yes, World Trade Center. Some people I heard of who that day were late in going to work, and it happened before they reached. Game of chance. So natural disasters are one of the symptoms. Another symptom is what I call human weakness and mortality. Symptoms of the fact that we live in a world that is in decay. Human life is beautiful, isn't it? And I don't mean the Miss Americas or Miss India or Miss Worlds or, you know, the Mr. Universes. I'm talking about just every human being. The Bible says we are fearfully and wonderfully made. As beautiful and as complex as our bodies are, despite its beauty and complexity, human life is as fragile as an eggshell and as brief as a candle. Those are not my words. I'm quoting someone. Fragile as an eggshell, brief as a candle. Even before we are born, sometimes the mystery of genetics can make things go wrong. We all know of spontaneous, unstimulated abortions. In a sense, you fight that battle with decay even before we enter into the world. And when we come to the world, of course, From the time we are born, even in our youth, the Damocles sword of sickness or accident hangs over us, and we heard a first-time testimony right now. A normal, healthy young man in his 30s, just taken away like that. We hear of youth, his lives being snatched away. Children, we live in ever-present possibility. Those of us sitting here today, all of us, none of us is immune from that. Can strike any moment. And as we get older, of course, the chances are even greater, for old age and death is basically in a waiting room, waiting for our turn, for the inevitable. We are mortals, friends. Our bodies are weak. And yet, most people act, talk, live as though we are going to live forever, right? Bad news. Thank God for all the fitness program, but there isn't a fitness program that can halt the aging process. Do you know of one? Can maybe postpone it for a while, make you look a little better for a while. There is no fitness program or dieting regime that can halt the aging process forever. There's no security agency that can ensure your complete safety, you know that. And no insurance scheme which can really provide 100% guarantee. An ancient philosopher put it like this. He said, when it comes to death, we all live in an unwalled city. When it comes to death, we all live in an unwalled city. Our lives are brief as a candle, fragile as an eggshell. And here is the thing, friends. You say, Pastor, this is depressing. Yes. And the bottom line is, we cannot do anything to change this reality. This is the way the world is. This is the way we are made. Can't change it. What we can do, what is in our control, is we can choose how we respond to this reality. And that is what I'm going to turn to in a moment. But that's the first and most important reason bad things happen to good people. Whether you're good or whether you're bad, we all live in a bad world, a world that is in decay, and which I've given you just a few symptoms. Secondly, why do bad things happen to good people? Bad people do bad things, but so do good people sometimes. Some of you are looking at me strangely. Bad and good people both do bad things. I've told you a couple of sources of evil in our world. Things beyond our control, right? Natural, you can't control earthquakes, you can't control storms, tsunamis, you can't control disease, you can't control death. However, most of the pain and suffering in our world results from what human beings can control. They are consequences of sinful choices and evil actions of people. And this is not hard to illustrate. I haven't read this morning's newspaper, but you can go back and open. I guarantee you, there'll be a story about rape. Someone's loved one murdered. Someone's child raped. Someone assaulted. Cheating. Exploitation. Social oppression, where the powerful oppress the weak. Injustice. Someone bribing to tilt the scales of the balance. War. And genocide. Oh, as I was reading and praying in preparation for this message, just in our last waking moments last night, I think I spoiled my wife's sleep by telling her something that, by the way, was news to me. Did you know the 20th century represents the pinnacle of human progress, right? Scientific and technological advancement is at its absolute peak. But in the 100 years between the year 1900 to the year 2000, and the population of the planet in 1900 was approximately 2 billion. But in those 100 years between 1900 and 2000, 10% of the world's population, 200 million lives were lost. I'm not talking about disease and natural causes. 10% of the world's population were wiped out in wars, genocide, or some other avoidable human act. Someone has said, the greatest enemy of man is, you guessed it, there's a cartoon that has become very famous, and it's coming up, this little boy looking at his face in the mirror. We have met the enemy and he is us. I don't have to illustrate this. This last week, I mean, one of the things that horrified me, and I don't know if it, please God help us never to become callous, where you open it and you just turn the page because you get used to it. Maybe never get used to it. What makes a father and mother burn alive their own daughter in the name of honor? What makes a father behead his daughter and parade her head through the village for his pride? The extent of human depravity. I've said it before, what kind of twisted mind makes a living by treating baby girls like mice or chickens, rearing them, pumping them with hormones to hasten their physical growth so they can be sold as sex slaves? People do these things, friends, in our world. And worse things as well. And I know you don't like it if I say this, but it's a fact. You and I are members of the same species that does such things. One of the US generals who's seen war, plenty of war, came back from the Rwanda genocide where 800,000 people were slaughtered in the space of 3 months. That's 2 World Trade Centers every day. And he said, don't call it bestiality. That's an insult to beasts. Beasts only kill 1 or 2 for food. Only human beings commit mass murders. If you're feeling complacent this morning and saying, oh, horrible, that's out there. These are what bad people do. I don't do such evil things. I have never raped or murdered or cheated anyone. I am good. You're missing the point, Pastor. So let bad things happen to those bad people. I am good. I have never done any bad thing to anyone in my life. Sorry to disappoint you. That's what you think. This is where I have to come a little closer to you and suggest to you that even good people do bad things sometimes. Oh, but not so bad. Hold on a minute. A good man. Have you heard of them? Maybe just a social drinker, doesn't drink much, but one night he's had one too many. And on the way home, kills a child. Good man. One mistake. But for the mother who's lost her child, that is the most painful tragedy of her lifetime. Something perhaps more common, the good guy, the nice guy, who promises lifetime love and loyalty to his girlfriend and dumps her. Vice versa. For her heartbreak, and in some cases, loss of virginity, what she was keeping for marriage, it's a terrible thing. It's a bad thing. And you may walk away thinking, well, it's a mistake. You may have broken his heart, young lady, and think, well, I made a bad decision, misjudgment. And I'm not criticizing you or condemning you from that. All I'm saying is don't say, I'm good. And I've never done anybody any harm. For there must be one case, two cases, 5 or 10 cases in your life when you have been the channel of a bad thing. I could go and on. A simple thing. You know, the woman who is a very good woman, upright woman, does social work. Maybe Rotary Club. She's active as the president. May even be a member of some church. But spreads a false, untested rumor and destroys a person's reputation. He loses his job because of that. Or he's engaged to be married and he breaks the rumor breaks up the engagement. Good people do bad things. The husband or father who has read every time he sees the ad, smoking kills, and still think, well, God made a mistake when he didn't create a chimney for me. And when he dies of cancer, leaving his wife a widow and his children destitute, that's a bad thing. That's a terrible thing. I can say more, friends, and it'll come closer home. All I want to say is none of us is really good. None of us have hands that are clean. It's only a difference of degree, not of kind. Remember, we all belong to the same species. And the best of us is capable of the worst. And why the Bible says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Will you tell your neighbor the bad news? Turn to your neighbor and say, come on, the best of us. Come on, come on, come on. The best of us is capable of the worst. The third reason why bad things could happen to good people. Bad things may have a good purpose. Many of you, in your mind, you just push that away. How can a bad thing have a good purpose? I could illustrate it in various ways. Let me just give you a simple illustration. How many of you think pain is good? How many of you think pain is good? Some of you. How many of you think pain is bad? Come on, come on, come on. You can't sit on the fence. How many of you don't like pain? Okay, let me say that. You don't like pain. Well, you're mostly normal people here. That's good. You can put your hands down. Yes. Pain is not a nice thing, is it? Is it a nice thing? Those who raised their hand, a few who said pain is good, they are wise. What they meant is pain has a good purpose. Did you know that pain has a good purpose? Tell me why. God has built the nervous system. God has built us with a built-in, it's called an alarm. Danger detection system. So when your finger goes near something hot, the pain tells you, don't go any closer. Why? Because if you put your finger in that fire, it's going to burn up your finger. You won't have a finger. Pain is good. Pain is something God has created to protect the body from damage. That little pain is intended to prevent greater loss. In fact, if you don't know exactly what I'm talking about, talk to a leprosy patient or somebody who works with lepers. And one of the main reason leprosy patients lose extremities is because of that. They don't have sensation of pain. So they don't know, a leprosy patient doesn't know when his finger or hand is in the fire. He has to see it to know it, because their pain detection system is not there. In fact, same thing with that awful toothache. You don't like toothaches. But if there's no pain, you'd lose all your teeth, my friends, and not know it. And they tell us the deadliest form of cancer is cancer that you are unable to detect because it doesn't cause pain. Yes, I like the way one man put it. This wise man, he said, as it comes on the screen, read it. Sometimes in tragedy, let's read it together. Sometimes in tragedy, we find our life's purpose. The eye sheds a tear to find its focus. I made you read it because it rhymes. Sometimes it's tragic. Sometimes in tragedy, we find our life's purpose. The eye sheds a tear to find its focus. So what good purpose do bad things serve? Very quickly, bad things shape character. They bring out the best in us. You show me a person. Who is mature. Who is emotionally balanced. Who is spiritually strong. Who is robust in faith. And I'll show you a person who has been through some pain. Pain shapes character. Not only that, pain builds compassion within the community. If you've ever been in the midst of a community crisis, either a famine or a flood or some other crisis, even riots right now, the Muzaffarpur riots, The stories that shine out are stories of one community sheltering members of the other community and risking their own safety. Pain builds compassion in the community. But thirdly and most importantly, bad things shape character, build compassion, but the most important thing bad things do, they turn our attention to the most critical issues of life. As we ride on the roller coaster of life, oblivious of the things which matter, on a journey where we have blinders on our eyes, bad things happen. And we wake up. And suddenly the most important questions of life hit us in the face. Questions such as, what is life really all about? Don't wait till it's too late. Till the candle is almost exhausted and you just have 1 or 2 years of active life left to think, really, what is life really all about? Kind of late. When you're on your deathbed. What lies beyond the grave? I told you, from the day we are born, we are headed in that direction. Why wait to ask that question until it's too late? But you know what? Tragedy, pain, has a way of pushing that in front of us. Of course, the most critical question of all. Whenever something hits you that's painful, why me, God? Right? And God says, hey, I didn't recognize your voice the first time I'm hearing it. God says, I was waiting. God, are you there? If so, where? Sometimes God has to smile with tears and say, I was waiting and waiting and waiting. And the only way I could draw your attention was by causing you pain. It hurts me much more than it hurts you. This great philosopher of the 20th century, C.S. Lewis, put it like this. He said, God whispers to us in our pleasures, speaks to us in our conscience, but shouts in our pain. It is his megaphone to rouse a deaf world. I've given you just 3 reasons, and there are many others, why bad things could happen, even to good people. But you know what? You may not be convinced, and I wouldn't blame you if you are not. Because when I face those bad things, when tragedy hits my life, it still doesn't make sense. It's hard. And there is a mystery at the heart of pain and suffering in the universe. So I don't claim to have the final answer in this talk, but the real question is what I want us to turn to now in the closing moments. The real question really is not why. The real question is how. How? How do I face, how do I cope with the bad things which happen? Friends, the real question is not why, but how do you cope? Various ways people cope with evil and suffering in our world. There are those who deny it. They say the world is not real because the world as we see it is a dream or Maya. Just wake up and get out of it. So the answer is escape or deny the reality of suffering. And in our country, of course, the way to do that is through moksha or nirvana. The second way to cope is fatalistic. Pain and suffering is a fact of life. No use trying to fight it. Your kismat mein hai. You know, it's can't change anything. Just bend and suffer. We have different words, naseeb, even karma. You can't do anything about it because it's your past life that determines things today. If you can't deny it, can't be fatalistic about it. There are those, especially in our generation, who think, well, there's so much pain and suffering, let's just try and escape it by drowning ourselves in alcohol or drug addiction. And it's a little bit like, if you've seen the movie The Titanic, as the ship is sinking, there's some who decide to have a last game of cards. Or play a last piece on the violin while the ship is sinking. Escape. Party the way through life. And then there are those who want to play the superhero Yes, life is full of pain and suffering. But I am tough. I am smart. I can beat anything that comes my way. Well, friends, if those are appealing to you, please follow them. But I told you, I'm not going to finish this talk until I give you the good news. Here is the good news, friends. There is another way. And I believe it's a better way. The good news is that God has come down himself and has broken the chains of evil and can free us from its power. I want you to read with me a portion of the Bible which captures this truth. Read it with me as it comes up on the screen. Therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ, our Lord, has done for us. We can rejoice too when we run into problems and trials, for they know that they help us develop endurance. And endurance develops strength of character, and character strengthens our confident hope of salvation. God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. So now we can rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God because our Lord Jesus Christ has made us friends of God. This is the good news, friends. God loves us. Regardless of who we are, where we come from, what our address is, what our status in society, he loves us. And he sent Jesus to die on the cross for us. What is the significance of that? On the cross, Jesus shared our experience of pain, of suffering. For the first time since Jesus came into the world, we have a God who has experienced human pain. But not only that, the Bible says that on the cross, Christ defeated sin, suffering, and death. In fact, he gave a death blow to death itself and dealt with the root cause sin. And the proof of that was on the third day he rose from the dead. That's the good news. This is not just a Christian message, please. It's not for Christians. In fact, many Christians miss it and have not benefited from it. This is a message for people everywhere of all color. All ethnic groups, all religions need to hear this message. Jesus, who came to free us from suffering, pain, and death. And so today, whoever you are, we can have a relationship with God through Christ and share in his victory. It's not about a religion, friends. It's about a relationship. Whoever you are, you can invite him into your life today. And from that day onwards, you'll be able to stand as you saw our sister Monica stand. And even though there's a storm all around, your anchor holds. Your anchor holds because you have a relationship with the one who's conquered pain, who's conquered suffering, who's conquered death. And who says, even though in this world you will have pain and suffering, I have overcome the world. Why do bad things happen to good people? Even if you don't have an answer, you can choose how you respond to those bad things. I want to just, in closing, as the team comment, we prepare to close. I want you, in closing, to consider these three choices you could make. The first is not through me. What do you mean by that, not through me? There's a lot of evil in our world, a lot of suffering in our world, a lot of pain in our world, which has human causes. I want you to decide this morning, it's not going to be through me. I refuse to be an instrument of evil. Instead, I will dispense good. Spread love where there is hate. Spread forgiveness where there is hurt. Spread hope where there is despair. Secondly, say the first thing. We don't sound very convincing. Not through me. Secondly, not bitter, but better. I don't know what may have happened in your life that causes you want to be bitter. You have a choice. You can choose to be better. And then thirdly, choose Christ. Choose Christ. If you really want to know what it is to be not just a conqueror, then more than a conqueror, choose Christ. Let's stand as the next passage comes up before us. We're going to read this together. This is a promise for everyone who chooses Christ. This is what it says. And we know. Let's try that again. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to His purpose for them. If God is for us, who can ever be against us? Since He did not spare even His own Son, but gave Him up for us all, won't He also give us everything else? Can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? No. Despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loved us. Listen to this. Neither death, nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today, nor our worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above, in the earth below, indeed nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. What does this mean? What does this mean? God took the very worst thing that happened in history, the death of Christ, the Son of God, and turned it into the very best thing that has happened in history. There's a day coming, friends. There'll be no more pain, no more suffering. The Bible teaches this life on earth is like one day as compared to 1,000 years in eternity. How can we rejoice after hearing about a tragedy? How can we still be strong? You know why? Because we're convinced that this is one page. A story that's 1,000 pages, and we know what the end is like. We know what the last page of that story is. The last page of the story is that everyone who has tasted the love of Christ, everyone who has entrusted his or her love to the love of Christ, will one day walk into an eternity which he has prepared. No more pain. No more sorrow. And all the bad things that we've experienced in this life will be a distant shadow of the past.